now 7:10, and we're going to call this meeting to order. This is the Conway Grammar School Committee meeting on March 16th. This evening, we're going to discuss our budget in great depth and open up to a public hearing. So just to get a few things out of the way, we will review and approve the minutes of February 11th, and I will entertain a motion.
Make a motion we approve the minutes of February 11th.
Second. Bill, any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, Patty has a financial statement for us as usual.
Yes, so tonight you're signing six warrants that total $28,944.51. And our reports look good. We are not, again, like we were saying, we're looking at the buckets, not so a couple of lines are over, but in total, we're okay. With all salaries encumbered through June, we're looking at still sitting on 212 through 2955 to get us to year end. And then on page 5, that's our school choice fund. We are running over in that by about $14,251. And that's just because we didn't have as much circuit breaker money as we thought we would, and it's not funding as much as we thought it would. The circuit breaker will be zeroed out by the end of this year. So right now it looks like we have a balance of $1,228.92, but we'll move a salary from school choice to use that up. Because we did not receive circuit breaker funds, we cannot have a balance in that account. The next page is page 7. That is our SPED tuition revolving. That's our WINGS account. And this takes into account only the payroll expenditures and a few other instructional materials. But it doesn't show you the revenue. It's just showing you the expense. So we have budgeted $238,567, and it looks like we're going to have about $130 left. But that could be only because the other expenditures aren't in here. This has been a process of us adding the funds every month so that you get a clear picture. Because when we talk about the budget, we talk about all funds. So you should see all funds every month. So we're going to be reporting on that. And then the last one is the early childhood, and that's running a little bit over because we had to hire someone to do some PD stipends. But again, we're over what we budgeted, but we should have money in the revolving account to cover the $3,000 because we're not seeing the revenue. And in June, we'll give you a final reporting of the revenue and the expenditure, so you'll see the balances in all of the funds. So that's all I have, unless anyone has any questions.
Question?
Nope.
For me. Okay. I assume you're all here for the hearing, so there's no comments from the public at this moment. Is that correct? We're going to go into a public hearing, but I have to open up for public comment prior to that. So if you have any comment, now would be the time. Okay. So, discuss the FY17 budget.
So before I turn it over to Patty for details, I'm going to let you read the narrative, the superintendent's message at your leisure. Basically, all of the budgets that we have presented to the school committees and the town boards this year, I look at as maintaining current services. We are not really creating any additional new programs. We are not adding new staff. The only thing that Dr. S. might want to talk about at some point is that we did have a retirement of a Spanish teacher, and they have a different approach to teaching world languages for next year. But what we have done with the other towns, and I think it makes sense, is to have Patty go through some of the increases and the summary of changes page, and then if anyone has any particular questions on line items, we can go back to that.
Okay. So we're presenting an FY17 budget in the total amount of $2,251,536. Of this amount, we will be asking for a town appropriation of $1,798,394. This is an increase of $63,674 from the prior year, or 3.68%. And I'll tell you how we got there. So right now, we do not have a negotiated collective bargaining agreement, but we do have to honor the steps. So we have 17 teachers and instructional assistants who are stepping, which will add $21,281 to the budget. We have one teacher with a degree change, which will increase their salary by $3,349. We have one teacher who achieved the next level of longevity with us, and one new, I shouldn't say teacher, I meant instructional assistant. So we had one instructional assistant who achieved the next level of years of service, and one new instructional assistant who just made the first step of longevity, which will cost $500. Currently, our substitute rate is $65 an hour or a day, and we are proposing to increase that to $75 a day to be more competitive. Mostly everyone in the area uses ASOP now, so these subs are shopping for their assignments, and they're going to go with the assignments that cost, that'll pay them $75 a day, and we're low at $65, so that'll add $1,800. We do have a contingency in here of $38,190 for unnegotiated raises for both union and non-union, and that's also combined with the increase of the central office benefits, the share of the central office benefits. At this time, we can't get more detailed than that because it is, it's still a negotiation.
We have settled, just to be clear on that, we have settled the contract. It has not been ratified yet. So until the contract's ratified, we cannot plug in officially the figures.
Okay, thank you, Superintendent. Yeah. We're decreasing a 0.2 FTE Spanish teacher, which will save us $14,308. And as the superintendent already mentioned, Conway Grammar School has a plan to replace that Spanish teacher with a different world language program, and we'll get to that when we get to the added costs.
Patty, do you want to be interrupted, or do you want to wait us to wait?
I don't care.
Okay.
Whatever you're more comfortable
just
with.
Just the 17 teachers with step increases, mm-hmm. is that a large number to have step increases in 1 year out of the total amount, or is that in line with what we...
You've got a younger staff. They're still stepping. And your IAs. You've got a lot of IAs that are still stepping. It's both.
Oh, and?
Yeah, it's a combination, Phil, of both. It's not just classroom
okay.
teachers.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
It couldn't be 17 teachers in sixth grade, is there?
No, there are not 17 teachers here. But it also would include people like a reading teacher or an art teacher or a
music,
the portion
PE.
Of there.
So altogether, our salary-related increases are $50,812. We do have some increases in the central office expense. It's personnel for whose salary we were paying on grants. One is our early childhood director. We were getting, we were allowed to put some of her salary on the kindergarten grant. The kindergarten grant, it's in, it's out, it's in, it's out. So we decided let's be on the safe side and budget it. And if money comes in, we will do something different with it than pay the partial salary. Two of our accounting staff were getting paid from a federal grant. And with the new EDGAR regulations, if you're not full-time, you can no longer do a partial salary. So we had to take those two salaries and put them in the budget as well. increase in building technology, Phil, this will make you happy, it's $8,000. I did have it doubled up. I spoke with my IT director, and what we already have in the budget, and we only need to increase it to $8,000 to get what he needs. We're doing a new way of, our technology director is looking at this. He took a very detailed inventory of all the schools, and he costed it out and looked at its age, and we are going to be replacing everything on a 3 to 5 year cycle, depending on the type of equipment, which will always put us ahead of the game instead of waiting till things break down and we're out, down and out. So this is what he needs to do that. It does not include any of our software costs. Those are separately in different accounts.
So this is not building technology, this is information technology?
It's all technology in the building, be it one-to-one devices, be it switches for the Wi-Fi, it's everything.
That's a yes to your
question. As opposed to physical plant.
What do you mean the physical plant?
Heating.
Thermostat.
It's the technology in the building, servers.
It would be considered what student use.
And admin use and
right.
Network use.
Right.
Instructional services, $6,300. These are for students who have some specialty services in their IEPs, which allow them to allow us to maintain them in the building and not send them out of district. And that is $6,300. Judy, maybe this is what you want to talk about. We added $7,000 to the budget to buy supplies, materials, and software for the new World Language Program. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Sure. Actually, we haven't called it World Language because I was wondering what it was. It's actually what we were going to be doing next year. Well, we decided as a staff that having a Spanish teacher or any language teacher to work with the kids 1 half hour once a week was not yielding what we would expect, that even with the most skillful teacher, that amount of time was barely covering the surface of what needed to be done. So the teachers formed a subcommittee to see what else could we do to combine culture studies and language. And the small committee of teachers, pretty much under the direction of Sue Siegel, decided that the school would pick perhaps 3 cultures in any given school year and do a culture study of South America, let's say, and incorporate some language into that study vocabulary, more or less, that was more realistic, that to study a culture and embed some language seemed more solidly based than sort of the attempt to really make young children fluent within that short amount of time.
Do you have a name for this program?
We don't. I think actually
I just called it cultural studies.
Culture studies.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I'll change it to cultural studies.
So this amount, I would imagine that this amount will cover any expenses that the teachers incur in order to make that happen. Some resources, maybe apps, maybe printed material.
I'll just note that Spanish teacher was the last historical vestige of what was a years-long town policy of doing exchange. Conway Grammar School used to do an exchange with the Mexican towns, and that was all pre-9/11, but we actually used to send our elementary school kids to a foreign country for a week.
I remember that.
Yeah.
And they all used to go, and it was the most popular thing. And it lasted for 20 years or something like that.
Yeah.
What grade?
That was fifth grade.
Yeah. And on forever.
Now people are freaking out with the nature's classroom.
I know.
Mexico.
Ah, times change.
That was a big deal.
Wow.
All gone.
So we also have an increase of $554 for our medical and health services. EpiPens are increasing in cost. And also we have the AED machines in our building, but we never budgeted for the replacement pads and the batteries. So we're increasing it by $554. And lastly, for increases, we are adding a new line item called building security systems for $4,320. This is money that's been in our building maintenance and repair line, and it really needs its own line. It's the inspections that we have to go through every year. It's the alarm. And they really shouldn't be in the maintenance line. So we're giving it its own line, and that'll free up more money in the maintenance line to do more maintenance for the building. So that gives us a total other operating increases of $34,189. And then other things that are decreasing are legal expense.
Can I ask about the building creation? If you're just moving that 4,000 out of maintenance, why does it show up as an increase?
Because I'm not decreasing maintenance. I don't want to decrease the maintenance account. I want you to have access to that 4,300 in the building maintenance, because our building maintenance line runs over every year. So, and primarily it's because you have to pay these reoccurring costs when it really should be there to buy paint, to paint rooms, or to, you know, do more maintenance in the building.
Okay, so it's a new line item and an increase.
It is an increase, because I'm not decreasing the building maintenance line.
Folks, I'm not sure who to address this to, but a couple years ago, it was understood that there was some more significant things that were needed, like the, I don't know if there was a power washer or a vacuum.
More equipment used
for maintaining the building.
Right.
And did we vote?
Did
we make a special appropriation for that? Or did we say that was going to come out of that maintenance account?
Nope. There were a couple of things that were to come out of the account that year, and then we also had an article to do a few other things. So all of the small line items on that maintenance list were taken care of.
Okay, great. All right.
Okay, so we're adjusting the school committee legal expense by 500. This reflects what more in line with our actual retainer is with our attorney. Decrease in technology professional development, 3,000. We don't need this line anymore because we are using the technology integration specialist. Decrease in special transportation, $4,000. This is based on what we used in 15 and 16 and what we're projecting for 17. And our regular transportation, our current contract has an annual COLA adjustment in it that's based on the consumer price index for the Northeast urban area, as defined by the U.S. Department of Labor Bureau and Statistics. And this year, the inflation factor was a negative, so we're actually going to save $5,764. And then lastly, you do have some savings.
Can I just stay on that? Because I was just following along in your, I don't know what you call them, page 13 of 26. It's the same exact thing that what you're talking about, but slightly more fleshed out. So what, I don't know what your terminology is, Patty.
The contracted services bill for transportation?
Yeah, it says 5764.
Yes, so the contracted services that are also going down?
The $4,000 is right underneath it for spend.
Okay.
Bus, special transportation.
So okay. Altogether, we're saving $9,764 on transportation.
Okay. What actually drew me to that page was I was searching for the food service thing, for cafeteria thing.
Uh-huh. We haven't done anything. We don't carry anything on our appropriation.
Remember, we have to close it out at the end of the year.
we don't budget for it.
Shouldn't we?
Well, we never have.
We haven't had a conversation about that. And there is a larger conversation we have to have about school lunch in all five schools, because all five schools are just draining money.
So the last 2 years, you've had to vote to spend money from either E&D or school choice to balance the budget. So. But this is the same scenario here as we're seeing, as Patty said, in all the other schools. So it's not just a conversation for Conway.
I hate to budget a loss, because then it's like I'm being defeatist, but because I keep hoping it won't be. And it's not just that it's a loss, it's also unpaid balances. So it's a number that usually with what savings we have at the end of the year, when we come in June, we'll just ask you, can we use these savings to pay that money?
See, I maintain that our willingness to make that a loss is actually what sets Conway slightly apart and makes us more unique. Our lunches are better than everyone else's. The food is better.
Everybody says that.
They spend a little bit more.
Then we need to charge a little bit more.
And they're worse at getting money from people because we don't want them suing people, and we kind of like it that way. They do. They want to.
But it is a larger conversation, whether people want to start budgeting a portion of a salary in the budget or continue to address it in the way we have, which is hasn't been very successful in the last couple of years.
So can we move on with the budget and leave that for another discussion?
It is another discussion.
And then lastly, the Conway's percentage of the central office expenses, besides the ones that we talked about earlier being an increase, there's a savings of $8,063 because your percentage fell from 11.74 to 10.71. So our total decreases are $21,327, which brings our total increase to $63,674, or an increase of 3.68%. So after you look at that page, which is page 7, your next pages are the line item detail of the town appropriation request.
But before we go on, and this may be more a question for Jan, the total appropriation, does that get split in our warrant between grammar school operating and employee costs? Because what I have for what we appropriated for operating expenses last year is substantially, it's about $90,000 less than what shows up here. And then there, so
you might be taking your transportation out. Most of the school.
Do take transportation out.
Yeah.
Yes, and that's almost $90,000. Okay.
Yeah, most of the towns do that. They
it's on a separate line.
That's
okay.
Great.
All right. Okay. So the transfer.
That's what the difference is. Thank you.
You're welcome. So then starting on page 16 of 26, this is a new way of presenting all of our funds that we use, and we're looking at it now all by line item. So you can truly see what we're spending for teachers, what we're truly spending for instructional assistants and everything. So everything is here. And if you look at the last page of this, which is page 24 or 23, you can look at the individual line items yourself. There's the, over to the right, the total FY17 budget will be $2,251,536. Town providing $1,798,394, or 79.87%. School choice $164,782, or 7.32%. The early childhood revolving, again, we're budgeting $25,000, or 1.11%. The wings revolving $231,799, or 10.3%. Title I, almost a half a percent, but that will fluctuate based on population, so that might go up a little, it might go down a little. And then we get $20,461 allocated to us from this Fed 94-142 grant, and that is where we get the total budget of $2,251,536. Now on the next page, I want to talk about school choice a little bit because...
what page?
The next page, 24, 26. We are no longer spending a year in arrears. Last year, we projected that we would get income of $156,438, and it only came in at $126,914. So we actually ended 15 with a negative $14,871. And then we only got the 126, so we technically only had 112,000, but we had 164,705 budgeted. So we're going to end this year with 52,662 less than we thought. Now that doesn't mean the fund will be negative, because we'll have the 15 funds in there plus the 16 funds have been coming in. But we're no longer spending a year in arrears. So when I project out for 17, we start with a negative 52. The December calculation says that we should get 148,737, which would give us a total of 96,075. But we've got 7.2 IAs on that budget, which next year will cost us $164,782. So again, we'll be spending almost half of our 17 money in 17, which is not what we normally do.
That's your cushion.
We have no cushion anymore. And I mean, the only thing we could do is move those back onto the budget, but then our 3.68 increase is going to go through the roof.
What has been happening throughout the district with different school committees, in an effort to come in with a lower overall percentage, people have been requesting that we put school choice money towards the bottom line to reduce the total increase. The problem is, when you do that, it gets compounded because our school choice dollars don't go up, ever. And the amounts that we charge against them, because they're often salaries, continue to go up. Mm-hmm. So again, this is not just particular to Conway. So it's just basically a cautionary tale to be mindful of this, knowing that you're not going to have a full year in arrears.
So it seems to me like we wouldn't want to go more than, you know, less than a half year, because then we start running into the revenue expense problem. Did we get enough money in to pay the salaries?
Right.
So what if we started, you know, like maybe taking a position out of there next year, just to start, you know, going in the other direction a little bit to try and control that balance some?
And I think that would be wise to do that. Deerfield found themselves in this position, and they spent last year trying to get back on track, which they have, because they too were concerned if there was suddenly an unexpected expense, they had no reserve to tap into.
So is it safe to put that off till next year, or do you think we need to address it sooner?
I am not aware of any changes in our population in the school that would warrant, you know, most of the time if we have an emergency, it's a kid that needs to go out of district. And Judy, correct me if I'm wrong, I don't think that we have anybody that is anywhere near that. So, I mean, I think we're okay. I mean, and we technically do still have more money in that account if we did have an emergency, but then we'd be fully spending the money as it came in.
What do you guys think?
It's not really enticing to start it this year.
No.
If I were to put one IA,
the economy is better next year.
If I were to put one IA back on the budget, it would bring us up to 4.96% increase.
And I don't think we want to do that this year.
No.
No, but I think we should start there next year.
Well, I'm making the note, and I'll reflect it in the minutes that.
And will you call and remind us?
I will call.
Marty and Judy get out of town.
Judy, you and I will call and remind them next year.
What did they say? And then the next page, 25, Jan, this is the one that you like to see, but I'm going to tell you, this is apples to oranges. So these, because with starting with 17, I started putting things in the right slots, but I didn't go back to 16 and really put them in the slots. So this is like an apples to oranges comparison, but our overall total spending is going up 2.61%.
Pretty good news. I'm sorry.
And then the last page is just the union percentages based on enrollment. And that's all I have, unless anyone has any more questions.
Can I run through a couple of line item questions? And then if you wouldn't mind, if we could sort of get through the committee questions first and then turn it over to the board. Does that sound reasonable? So on the summary, there's a decrease in
what
technology.
Professional development.
Is it 7 of 26? Yeah. Technology professional development. Can you explain that one more time?
Sure. Last year at this time, we had come to you with the proposal of the technology integration specialist, and Conway at that point did not want to join. So we had previously had a line item in our budget of $3,000 that would, that Judy and her staff would use to do professional development around technology.
Yes, I remember now.
Right. And so when we brought on, the integration specialist part year, we used those funds to fund that position. And then this year, we can delete them out because her position is now in your assessment piece. So we can delete the $3,000 line item.
Okay. That makes sense. Down on other instructional hardware, 2453, it's page 11 of 26. The $20,000 in that line item. I know we've been through this, but I need to drill it in one more time.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Where is it?
Page
11 of 26, yeah. On the very bottom, under instructional hardware, the $20,000.
Oh, right. The $20,000 is the amount that Scott needs to keep everything going, to make the current lease payments, and to keep the three to five year rotation he wants to be on for the replacement. But we already had $12,000, and if you remember, Phil brought that to my attention the last meeting. So I went back and I said to Scott, do you need 20 at more than the 12, or do you just need 20? And he said, I just need 20. And if you already have 12, then the budget's only going to go up 8,000. Okay. So the budget's going up 8,000, but then if you look at, we take out the 3 for PD, it's technically only going up 5,000.
Mm-hmm. Right. And does that include hardware as well? I mean, like purchasing of iPads or?
It's everything.
Yeah, Judy talked with Scott and went over to all the personal devices and.
It's everything but the software. So NWEA, which is our testing software, that's going to be under testing and assessment. Typing without tiers, that's going to be under our instructional software line. Our Rediker system will be under district-wide administrative data. So it's parsed in a few different, the Crocker, who provides our internet service, that's under networking. So all the pieces are in different things, and I tried to pull them all together on that last page of analysis to show you the total technology number in the building, which would include the software and everything else.
Okay. And a couple of lines up from that, we have a 222% increase under other instructional services.
Right, and that was the 73, I talked about that, it nets out to 6,300, the instructional services. That's, we had 2,300 in there, and Karen needs the 6,300 more for summer services, and also the specialized services in the IEP. Some of them are vision, some of them are for the ABA consultant.
So the jump,
again, we're reclassing things. So that might have been in out of district tuition, summer services, but no one's out of district anymore. So we're moving it. So I mean, there is a little bit of difficulty. Everything's not lining up penny to penny because I'm also making changes as to where we're classifying things. Mm-hmm.
So the extra 9,000 in contracted services was what?
That's the ABA consultant. We have students that need vision consultants. Do we have any children still, Judy, with hearing devices?
Yes.
Yes. So that's their share of Clark.
And you moved that from where?
Part of that, she used to put it in tuitions, and it's really other instructional services.
Okay. So where was tuitions? Where did it come out of?
That would have been on the bottom. And I made the changes in 15 so I could try to line it up, but it didn't go exact. So that is zeroed out. So in 16, it could be in a bunch of different lines, and I'm trying to get everything where it should be, but I didn't go back to 16 and say, well, where's the other half of this? It could be under the reading camp, which used to be gifted and talented, but we're not using those titles anymore, so I have to go back like a detective and say, where's my sheet? How did I line these up? But I can get you the crosswalk
Yeah, I'm just trying to see when we add on something there, like the $9,000 in contracted services, what did it come out of? Where did we see it? That's it.
Right. And I'll get you a crosswalk to do that.
Okay. Let's see. There was also a 100% increase in parent liaison services, $3,100.
No, we don't have any here.
No, that was $350. Would that have been three? We did.
That was a small number anyway. Well, actually, I was wondering where that came from because there was no number in the FY17.
That $350 was the number that the town of Conway used to pay one of our staff members.
Why don't see a $350? Are we in the right place?
What page are you on?
Well, I'm going back and forth because I took notes on the other one. It's the line item $3,100.
Page 12, 26.
Right.
And then wraps to the next page.
Yeah, so it doesn't have anything in the FY17 budget but an increase of 100%.
It's 100% change. It should be like negative because
okay,
it was zero.
So
it's just,
that's a zero. Yeah. Okay, so it just caught my eyes.
But that used to be the money that you would pay to have the total census, student census done, and we're not charging the towns anymore. We changed that stipend. We had discussed that, how he was getting a stipend,
mm-hmm.
and technically he's an employee, so we rolled that into his hourly, that stipend into his hourly rate.
Okay. And 4225 building security systems.
That's what I talked about.
Making sure that was
yeah.
that. Okay. That was it for me.
Page 15, you could talk about the 138% increase in insurance.
I can't talk about that. I said that. We're negotiating, so I can't talk about anymore.
Isn't the big chunk of that retirement?
It's
the same number.
That's the line. I can't break out into any more detail, Phil, until the contract's ratified. But part of it is the increased cost of central office benefits and a contingency amount to negotiate union and non-union salaries.
Is that our new principal salary in there too?
Union and non-union?
No. That hasn't been negotiated yet either.
Right. There's a contingency in
right.
there for all negotiations.
So where is that? So that's the contingency in there as well? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Good.
I like the changes and how you're laying things
yeah.
out.
Yeah. Thank you, Lynn.
I'm sure it was summer. I don't know.
I like the second page here of the totals.
Okay. I wish you'd give to the accountant I had at work a tutorial on how to create that.
Did you have any more questions before I turn it over to the
transportation?
Yeah.
Is that 9? We don't need 9. We're cutting it with 13. We're cutting it down to 9.
Where does it reflect the amounts that we're paying for elementary charter out?
Okay.
That's the town's responsibility. I don't budget that.
That's not. Okay.
It's taken out of our state revenue.
Yeah, that's on the cherry sheet, actually. I just saw that. That's right. Choice and charter shows up on the columns of the cherry sheet.
Okay.
Questions?
I got mine out of the way.
What's the number?
The transportation.
Oh, okay.
Getting the cutout. I have a couple of questions. So if you look at page 7 of 26 and then on 23 of 26, in the fiscal year proposed, it's like $6,000 more on the page 23 versus on page 7. Are we looking at the same number there?
Hang on, let me get there. 23 and 7.
I
Well, seven's just the changes. What you're looking at on page 23 would line up with page...
Well, no, you have a line there that says fiscal year 17 Conway Grammar School budget. That's not a change. So I don't know if it's a typo. I don't know if it's...
Okay, tell me again where you are.
Okay, page 7 of 26. Go five lines up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six lines up from the bottom.
1,792,630. Is that what you're talking about?
Yes. 1,792,630. And then on 23 of 26, it's
1,798,394.
Oh, you're right. There,
so
maybe it's a typo.
Right there with 7.
Hmm?
On page 3. Is that number?
Where's that?
Page 3.
Yeah.
Town appropriation note.
Which is it?
798. Well, that's the right. If that number shows up again, as Tom points out on page 3, so it's the 7. It's the bigger number that shows up on page 3. So maybe it's just a typo.
No, everything's linked. So
okay. So there's just it's a cell.
I have a broken link.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Well.
1,798,394.
Now you're gonna drive her nuts.
Well, I got another question. Maybe I. So preschool. So there's an increase in programming. Is that what's going on?
No.
Because that number went up sizably, like 30 some odd thousand.
There's two IAs in there. We have one child that has a one-to-one aide in our preschool now. Okay. So that's what's driving that. Usually it's the teacher and one aide, and we had to add an aide for a child that has one-on-one services.
Out of here it says 178.
I know, and now I'm trying to find out where my link is broken.
Well, the pages of preschool stuff.
There was a one-to-one in there last year too, though.
Right there.
Oh, and not there isn't this year, but there's going to be next year. Is that what's happening? Okay.
Our preschool programs, again, not just Conway, all over the district, are blowing up with students who are coming in needier and needier. And when they have those needs, they come to us at age 3 and will stay with us 3, 4, go to kindergarten and 5. And we are responsible for them from the age of 3 to the age of 22. And we're seeing an influx of students with more and more needs.
The difference between those numbers is 5,764, which is
equal to the transportation increase.
Decrease in regular transportation. Yeah.
The plot thickens.
So let me go. Did I not change this?
It seems like that's the only place that number is, right?
Yeah, I'm seeing the 1,798 number everywhere.
No, I didn't. When I changed my transportation number on my detail list, I did not change it in my other. So it's showing as 70,000, and it should be. You gotta forgive me too. I'm adjusting to new bifocal contact lenses, so I am really having a hard time seeing. So apparently they don't work. 68,762, and if I plug that at 68,762, we are now at 1,792,630. Is that consistent? 1,792.
Yes.
Okay. Problem solved.
So that's the correct number.
Yeah. 1,792,630 is the correct number. And everywhere else right. I have it, a different okay. is wrong.
So is it still 3.68%?
Yes. It still is.
Okay. That's cool. What is that?
So I made that late change and then didn't carry it through.
Good catch.
You guys are sharp. Thank you. I try to be perfect, but I am a human.
And where's the detail on the preschool? I'm looking for where I...
Where Tom was looking?
It's where? It's in the page...
Page 7.
7.
No.
Well, that includes the 5,764.
He's asking about preschool.
Yeah, there was... I didn't just make up...
No, you were on page 25, where they give the
right where I
the
broke
all
it
funding
out.
Sources compared year to year, and so you, and then you saw that big increase
right.
in the preschool line. There,
yeah, she said that was apples to oranges.
And that's the IA.
If they did, right.
So it's basically a salary, basically?
And that's what I'm saying, on that page, we can't really, I can't, it's hard to detail, because this year, I've got all my IAs labeled. So there could have been two last year, but I only had one labeled as early childhood. And then we sat down, Judy and I sat down, and we went through all the assignments, and so they're correct. And I just haven't adjusted 16. So this is like an apples and oranges kind of comparison. But it's one that Jan likes to see, so she can see the total funding difference.
Right. And so you're saying this year, and this is statewide, you would say, that their needs are greater than ever before.
Mm-hmm. It's not just throughout the state. This is more of a
country.
Yeah, an episodic thing. I mean, there's a lot of speculation that the amount of screen time that our toddlers are getting is influencing their language development. There may be other factors as well, but what we're seeing is an increase locally, countywide, and statewide of students in preschools, private preschools, who are being kicked out because of behavior difficulties and emotional difficulties that the public schools are now having to address.
So, you ought to be taxing Microsoft, Intel, and Apple for this stuff. Because so there's nothing further coming from the state or the feds, I don't imagine.
And it's happening very quickly.
Letting them sit in front of screens.
No, but it's out.
Just blame the device.
The word is, these days, the word is out there. Under two, they're not supposed to be in front of screens at all, right? I mean, that's...
And that was one of the things that struck me when I was speaking to the early childhood director. You know, she said that everybody's doing this, so the children are coming and they can't even stack blocks. They don't know how to manipulate things with their hands because they don't do that anymore.
Yeah, that's been true for a while.
And that just floors me.
And you give them a pen and they don't know how to hold it. They can go to kindergarten.
Right, the thing is, you really do want to get them in early to your school system and try to get them engaged in your school system so later you don't have out-of-district placements because parents are out there and say, well, you can't possibly service my kid. If you get them integrated into your community, you have a chance that they think my kid's better here, which more times than not, they are better in their community school.
We also had really sophisticated early interventions. Mm-hmm. So parents can access services for one-year-olds, two-year-olds, three-year-olds. So by the time a three-year-old comes to preschool, he or she has already been identified in many, many areas. I mean, it's sort of, it's a good thing that they're early identified, maybe the little bit of the downside is that, you know, you have to service these children because they've already been identified.
But if it's a simple remedy, preventive remedy, we ought to get the word out to more parents.
Kill your television.
And everything else.
We do have community engagement. We do have play groups that run, that Karen Green runs in the district as well.
It's easier said than done. I know you have siblings, the older ones. You really, you can't win. You can't win.
Well, it's also not just screen time. I mean, the high rates of autism, they've yet to really pin down. Is it environmental? Mm-hmm. Is it, you know, socialization? Is it, you know, older people having children and using, you know, drugs, you know, to and all sorts of ways to get pregnant when people normally wouldn't, you know, so, you know.
I thought that's just become a catch-all term for lots of conditions that aren't otherwise covered by insurance.
Autism is covered by insurance.
Anyway, let's move on. Are there any more questions on the budget?
Well, they've actually changed the spectrum.
K through 6 from town. Not preschool, K through 6.
How many
town kids?
We have that number right
here. 156?
117 are not. So 156 minus 17 would be 139.
But he said not preschool.
Oh, did I count preschool?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's projected for next year or that's
what we have now.
Mm-hmm. We just got three more last week, so we have three additional children.
Three additional school choice, or?
No, three additional. Who moved in?
Lubin?
Just moved.
It's a popular place, I tell you.
So 139, K through 6?
No, I think I counted the pre-K, so what would it be, Marty?
Preschool.
Plus wings.
I have 143.
143 minus the school choice. You didn't want school choice, right?
Do you want school, that includes school choice. That's K through 6, including school choice.
So it's 126.
Yeah.
It's 143.
It's 143 in total, 17 are school choice, so that would leave us 126 kids.
Yep.
That are native Conway Indians.
So what's the number for the town resident, town kid?
126.
Yes, 126.
I'm saying 143, that sounds too high.
126.
Okay, thank you.
Do you have any families that represent?
No.
Okay, are we ready to move on? Are you satisfied?
So I do have a question. It's not on this budget, but it's on the capital plan for the school. Is this the appropriate time to raise that?
Sure, yeah.
Okay, so we've been putting $50,000 a year into a grammar school stabilization account, and I guess that's been maybe earning some interest. It looks like we did that, I'm guessing we did it for 3 years, because there's $184,000?
We did less than $50,000 one year.
We did, okay, so maybe we did more.
Less than $50,000 each year.
We've been trying to do it.
Okay, so we did less than $50,000 one year.
I don't remember which year it was, or how much, what was less.
I'm just wondering if we could do less than $50,000 again.
We voted at last month's meeting.
Yeah, we voted to ask for $50,000, because we have, you know, significant long-range goals to take care of some bigger projects. I don't have them in front of me now, so to the best of my memory, though, they are.
The boiler.
The boiler.
Remember the boiler, two boilers, right?
They're the same ones that we've been talking about for a long time.
The roof's okay, isn't it?
We hope so.
We hope so. There's still a couple of small leaks here and there that we're working on.
Bathroom partitions.
So.
Bathroom partitions.
So what?
The heat and ventilation system, we want to upgrade eventually to digital controls.
So we did the same thing, similar thing in Deerfield. We had a stabilization fund for the roof. And what happened was, then we applied for MSBA money, which for our boiler replacement, we may be doing that as well. And this gives us the startup money for the schematic design phase. And it worked out really well in Deerfield, because we already had the money for the design, the schematic design phase, before the town had to go out to bond and do all that. So I think this is a great idea to continue, because absolute bathroom partitions won't be MSBA reimbursable, but our boiler, actually, we could get that in as a MSBA project under the accelerated repair project.
So how much of it is reimbursed?
We have an aging septic system.
I think it's a minimum of 50%.
Really? Well, that would behoove us to try and.
Right.
Deerfield just got 52% for their roof.
Well.
Replacement, so.
So they're only paying 48% of an almost $3 million roof.
What else besides the boilers?
Our septic system is aging.
Heat.
We replaced.
Heat and ventilation.
Not the whole leach field, but we replaced the tanks.
Is there a?
Generator, generator?
There is.
There is a list, and there's only really those large items.
Bathroom partitions.
Those are expensive.
Crazy expensive.
I do have one last comment. On the technology piece, that seems a little odd to me, because this is a 3 to 5 year capital expense, and yet you're putting it in the operating sort of budget. Is there a lot of other items like that, or is that the only thing that comes to mind?
It needs to be, now that we're moving more and more, moving the school with technology, it's going to be like the textbook line. It's going to be a recurring cost every year.
So it's more like a lease payment then?
Right.
We are leasing our equipment.
Okay.
At least the one-to-one devices.
Good.
Okay, so if we, just, you know, an idea came to my head that, you know, the town is putting together its capital plan for replacing vehicles and maintaining buildings and so forth. I think the school could use some help with that too, and long-range planning, how much we need to put away each year to meet our goals.
We'll be starting a long-range planning process in the fall. And we'd be happy to have somebody from the school sit in on that.
Okay. Myself and Mr. Lesko would be happy to do that. Because one of the things, not just the bathroom partitions, one of the things that is driving the cost is the cost of paper goods. And we would love to get the paper towels out of the bathrooms, but we would need a capital outlay for the electric hand dryers. So it would be a lot of money up front. So we were thinking, why don't we do partitions and dryers? Because everybody's bathroom partitions need to be replaced, and we'd like to get hand dryers in. But that would be a cap. So we're trying to get together a cost of what that would cost to do all the bathrooms mm-hmm. in all the schools. Mm-hmm. And
that's a perfect thing for stabilization.
Right. And you have stabilization. But like at Frontier, then we run into the problem that we have no method through the regional agreement to assess the towns for a project like that. So we run into these stumbling blocks.
Okay.
Is that list available in electronic format?
Yes.
You got it?
I know, I've seen it.
Yeah.
Oh. Lesko's list.
Yeah, it's the same list there. You've had it. It's really the same list.
I think he presented it 2 years ago.
It was, yeah, 2 years.
Yeah.
2 years ago.
We'll get it to you again.
We're looking at the, I just don't know that.
I think the town might
know. 50,000, I know we'd like to do the 50,000. So
are we at the levy?
There's a lot of, unknowns still. I mean, it's an interesting, this is a little more challenging
year
for us, for the, especially, there's going to be a big increase in taxes, that's for sure. Right. But are we going to need an override? I think that's where we're trying to tinker with what we can get away with.
Do you have our stabilization balance in front of you?
Yeah, so it's for the grammar school stabilization, as of just January 31st, it was this $184,029.48.
How much?
184,029.48.
Right, and it says that for revenue, I guess this fiscal year there's 52,223.95. So I'm guessing that means we voted 50,000 in, and then the two grand must be interest, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
That's
a pretty good interest rate.
It is
a good
amount.
Wow.
Good.
I
like that interest rate.
Yeah. Jan, can you take some of my money?
Put that in that.
So another 50 would bring us up to 234, which is just about where that we had 250 in Deerfield when we applied for MSBA for our project. So and we're not at the end of the life cycle yet for the boiler. We're not at the point where we want to apply yet. So.
Yeah. Well, the heating and ventilation was kind of the biggest ticket item we had on there.
Right.
The boiler's not small, and the septic system is not small.
And unfortunately, they're all linked, from what I understand, in many ways.
And the building is aging, and we haven't put any big expenses besides the roof.
We did just replace the septic tank.
We did
the tank.
We did the tank, but not the tank.
How did we do that?
I think it's stabilization.
No, we didn't do it.
Budget savings and heat.
budget savings each.
Okay. Was what?
After we put the new roof on.
So it was a $10,000 expense or something like
that. Right, but I think from what Bob's presentation, these things are very much linked. So you're not just going to go and put in your new digital whatever without a boiler.
Right.
You know what I mean? So it's like, it's not, you can do, it's kind of all connected.
So do we have an exact plan of how much we need to each year to like I said, to meet our goals? No, we really need to get together with the town and make that plan. But I don't think that we should skimp on what we're saving now, because we're a long way from our goal.
And the clock's ticking on these things within the school.
And the complete septic thing was a big ticket item, because if that ever, I mean, we did replace some of it, but the field and the pumps going up to the field, I mean, it's a designed system. It's not, you know, there's a lot to it. And
it was more proactive to it, to us to do it in the summer than wait for it to break down in the winter.
That was Bob's fear, that it would be in February, everything would be frozen.
So this was just on last summer?
We needed a new tank last year. Right, our tank was falling apart.
Yeah, actually it did. It actually like flaked. It all like flaked.
We had four different opinions.
Yes.
We had four different people with four different opinions on what on the shape of that tank.
On the deterioration?
Yeah.
Was any of them blaming the kids?
It had to do with the pump that failed, and the buildup of gases in whatever of gas that ate away at the concrete in the tent. Does that make sense?
That's one theory.
That's
theory.
Yeah, that was the theory.
That Phil liked the best.
No. I mean, that was I remember, because I was dealing with a septic thing in my own house at the same time, and I was paying attention to that.
So that's the scoop.
That was the scoop.
Okay.
All righty.
Which rhymes with.
Can we move along?
Yep, we can. And I just want to keep making sure everybody's done. All right, so are we ready to vote or on our budget? Okay. I want to get this motion correct. We're going to make a motion to vote on our budget, so I...
We want to make sure we're voting the right number, Pat.
Yes. So...
Can you do a total budget of $2,251,536, or a 3.68% increase?
Okay. So moved.
Second. Wait a minute. The numbers changed.
1,792,630.
Right.
Right.
Okay, that's what you said. Okay.
No, I said a total budget of 2,251,000.
No, it's now 2,245,772.
That I do not have. That is important.
2,245,772. Mm-hmm. 1,792,630 from town appropriation.
179. Yep. Is it still a 3.68% increase?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So 2,045,722.
No. 2,245,772. And then the town would be 1,792,630, and revolving funds and grants of 453,142.
Okay. So I move. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. All right, are you going to give an update on building maintenance, or was that already?
Yeah, no, I actually just quickly referred with Judy that, as you remember, last month we talked about leaks in the roof, and that has stabilized, and Bruce did get pricing on garage doors. And that's going to be able to be replaced at the current maintenance.
On the committee has always had emails. She just chair files.
Yeah.
So when are we going
to need to get paper too?
I don't know exactly, except Bob had a guy come in and repaired them, and
in our mail slot.
It's no longer leaking, but I don't know beyond that.
And they're open.
Yeah.
Was it ice dams, or was it ice dams? I think. I'll give you an update on the principal search. I think you all are pretty updated, so this is more for the public. But we have selected two candidates. They are here in Conway this week. This morning, we had our first candidate for a coffee hour with parents at 8:30. And then they visited classrooms, or she visited classrooms, had lunch with the teachers, and an interview with Marty this afternoon. So tomorrow, the same schedule will repeat for the second candidate. And then...
Did many parents show up?
Yes, there was, I'd say,
20.
Maybe 20. Yeah, 20 parents. It was good conversation. It went very well. I thought it was great.
Good feedback. And then after I meet with candidate number two, I'm going to go out at 3:30 for the staff meeting and have a chance to get feedback from the Conway teachers. And then I meet with the search committee on Monday
committee
morning.
The search committee will come on Monday morning and brief Marty and tell her about the site visits and all of the information that they've gained.
Yep.
And then Marty will make her decision.
That's right. So I'm getting lots of input. I appreciate it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Do we have a collaborative report?
Nope. Nothing since last meeting.
I don't think they've met.
They have.
Yeah. So I haven't gotten any collaborative reports from anybody this.
On to the principal's report. Night.
Night.
Thank
Thanks you.
For coming.
Well, for some reason, I thought Bob Disco was going to this meeting, but I think I misread something. So anyway.
At least it wasn't the time.
Look, I was here on time.
That's right.
You don't leave. Just to keep you informed, Bruce did paint the fifth grade classroom during the February vacation. And during that vacation, some pipes in the above the teacher's bathroom froze, and of course, burst. And Bruce and Jeannie came in, and with Bob Lesko managed to clean up the place. Bob then sent a carpenter, I believe, the following day to see what was going on there. It looks like insufficient insulation, and so that was upgraded and put in there. They also inspected behind sheetrock to be sure there was no moisture there. That turned out to be just fine. I also just feel like we should acknowledge the fact that the alarm went off around 9 o'clock, and Bruce and Jane both came down to start the cleanup, and then Bob joined them.
Judy, I did send them an email thanking them.
Yeah, just thought sort of for the record, and since we're being televised, that we would want to acknowledge it sort of above and beyond. So thank you to both of them. I actually just have a few activities to report on this evening. We did have our all-school sing, I think it was the first week in March, and we now have a ukulele band, and they're actually quite good and entertaining, and we heard them for the first time. I think there may be a dozen of them. We did have other selections from the chorus, and some teachers, I thought this was a good idea, some teachers organize events that would take place right after the all-school sing. So it was a draw for parents to attend the all-school sing and then either to go to first grade or second grade, whichever teacher had notified them that they were invited to a reading or a math lesson. So it was very well attended, actually. On March 2nd, we celebrated Read Across America. We started with all the kids in the gym. I read Pete the Cat, which was a lot of fun. And we did have a variety of activities throughout the building. You know, kids came with their sleeping bags and basically read all day in their classrooms. There were get-togethers from sixth grade, read to preschoolers, fifth grade, went down and read to kindergarten.
teachers rent to other classrooms in addition to their own. We had a couple of parent volunteers who were in the library and read to small groups of children. It was actually a wonderful day.
I read Itty Bitty Kitty to the first graders, and they said I did such a good job I could keep the book. So I took it.
I forgot you came with that.
Yeah,
you actually kept it?
It was fun.
Well, you deprived those first graders of future Itty Bitty Kitty moments?
I said, do you think my grandchildren would like this book?
God.
And this one little boy said to their teacher, don't you think we should give this to Mrs. Barrett and she can rate the book? So last weekend I drove to Connecticut and read the book to two of my granddaughters and they gave me a thumbs up.
There you go.
So I have to report back to that.
Good.
That's awesome.
I forgot you joined us. That was fun. And we remember to sing happy birthday to Dr. Seuss that day. It's his birthday. Conway Moves and Grooves. This is really a wonderful program that the teachers put in place. I think that Paulette and Meg and Jen Wheeler, Maggie West, and Jill designed the program and started March 1st. Basically, it happens on Tuesdays. Kids have signed up that they want to participate. The mileage around the building and down the driveway is clearly marked. And for Tuesday recess, they either run that mile or walk and run or some combination of it. We have a number of parents who are joining us also. And I noted here, I think really the important thing is that it's totally non-competitive. Nobody's running against anyone. The chart that's kept is just mileage. So everybody's mileage is joined together. I think they have over 240 miles since they began March 1st. So that's a lot of mileage.
Yeah.
Little kids, the older children, they absolutely love it. They come dressed to run that day.
That's awesome.
It's a good way to keep the kids moving for sure. And that it's not competitive. Just sort of a shout out to the PTO. I met with them and they said, you know, we have some revenues we would love to use towards sort of refreshing whatever you use on the playground in terms of balls and sandbox toys and so forth. So Arlene, the PE teacher, met with a group of teachers and the playground monitors who really know what they need out there and compiled a wish list for the PTO. PTO got back to us and said they could fund the entire list. So we're really grateful that they thought about that and are willing to fund what we suggested. So we should have more jump ropes. I think outdoor chalk was a bunch of stuff. So thank you, PTO.
Thank you.
You're welcome. That's awesome.
Sure, I'm going to pass out a superintendent's report. As I had told you before, in November and December, we completed a district self-assessment for the Department of Education. We uploaded hundreds and hundreds of documents. And last week, we had Betsy with a team of five people who came out and spent 3 days. Unfortunately, about a week before they were to come, they said, oh, we just are going to audit the high school. So sorry for your preparations for everything else.
Oh,
so so they came, and I asked if they would come back and audit the elementary schools, and they said, highly unlikely. People are, I think, often confused on the eastern part of the state when they say Frontier Regional School District. To us in Union 38, it means all five schools. It was a surprise when they were getting materials for the elementary and they said we didn't really need to do that. Anyway, I did have the opportunity.
I was the parent. I was a parent volunteer interviewing from them whenever they needed to bring their parents. They were completely useless.
It was a fairly brutal process because we were being compared to, there are 14 districts in the state that are 7 through 12 districts. And we were being compared on our MCAS scores on middle and secondary level. And there are only 8 other schools in the state that chose to do MCAS. The others all did PARC. And when I reminded them that our scores were only compared to those 8 other schools in the state, they went, uh-oh, that's a very good point. I'm trying to always try to find something good in this, because it was a brutal process putting all of the documents together. It did cause us to sit down and have discussions about our curriculum management program, about our professional development, about our assessment and instruction. So that is the silver lining. They were quite impressed with our early release and professional development plan. And they were quite impressed with our district determined measures. So those were our kudos. They weren't as impressed with our 8th grade math scores, and we are working on that. Anyway, I did also have an opportunity last Friday to meet with the 16 legislators, along with many other superintendents. We had 4 state senators and 12 state legislators who came to the lunch. We spent a great deal of time asking them questions about charter and choice funding, regional transportation, early childhood reimbursement.
And did they have any answers?
Well, as I've said to other school committees, this is why I'm not a politician, because I thought, I'm going to listen very, very intently to what they're saying. And I did. And they're very good
at not saying.
I mean, Senator Rosenberg is,
we're going to win again.
Well, I think he's very supportive of the concept. He does understand the impact, because I, along with other superintendents, gave them raw data as to what it really does to our school districts. But I think they're probably between a rock and a hard place with all the pressure they have from the eastern part of the state. If I had to bet, I would guess that they're going to lift the cap on charter schools. And I would bet that we are going to have more charter schools. And I would bet that we're going to have more funding deferred from the public schools into the charter schools. That would be my bet. I appreciate that they took the time to listen. I don't know if it's going to come to fruition as far as action on that.
Why don't they make self-funded charter schools?
Well, or just...
So you can't start a charter school until you can fund it yourself.
Or even fund the current formula that they have, which is 100% the first year and 25% for the next 4 years. If you could even fulfill the obligation that you created to begin with, we'd be in better shape. But they haven't done that. So anyway, and then just, you know, we are continuing with a policy subcommittee. As I mentioned earlier, we did reach a settlement with the elementary IA and elementary teachers. It's being reviewed right now by the union. Once I get those copies back, the 2 attorneys write something up, and then we hopefully will get ratification. So it's unofficially official. And Phil was a trooper. He hung in with me. We've been doing this since October.
That took a long time.
It took a long time. It was a lot of meetings.
You're just starting Frontier.
I know, but I...
It's no coincidence that It was no coincidence that it lasted until there was no further scheduled meetings.
Right.
At that point, the attorneys, everybody else, they were ready then. No further scheduled meetings? All right, let's get it done. That's about...
Yep, so I had all my contract husbands, which I called all the guys. It was me and the guys, and we met 2 or 3 times a week. We had dinner, we spent the last one time 5 hours together.
How did Steve Barrett feel about that?
Yeah, it was a long haul. So thank you, Phil.
Came together nicely. You did a really fine job.
Oh, well, thank you. So
your 3rd year, you're coming into your own year.
I am. I finally figured it out, Phil. So that's what I have.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, I guess we come to the end of the successful meeting.
I didn't even tell you this morning. Laura, before Laura left, she said that the April meeting, if it's on
a joint meeting, a 6th?
No. Our regular meeting is canceled.
Yes.
Okay. because on the calendar, it looks like it's on the same day as the school show.
Oh, we don't have to worry that, no.
Okay, good.
No. I mean, sometimes if we need for a problem, we'll call an extra meeting, but we have a joint meeting on the 6th.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Take it back.
So we don't have our regular meeting in April, which
No. It's May.
It's that round robin.
We have the little meeting in the side room.
Yeah.
To give financial reports, sign the warrants, and
So it's April 6th?
I believe so. Do you, that's a Thursday.
It's Wednesday.
April 7th.
Then maybe it's the 7th. It's that last, let me see. Right. Make a mistake.
April 1st is a Friday, so that's the 7th.
Joint school committee meeting, 7 p.m.,
yeah,
April 7th.
Yeah,
yep.
6 o'clock.
Yep.
6 o'clock.
Oh, 6? I have 7.
You do? I have 6.
Well, let's see how we do on this one.
Winner, winner.
Stay tuned. You know what? The Frontier changed all their meetings to 6. Correct?
Yes.
So I have a feeling that
so
I think you are 6.
Frontier and Waitley switched to 6. Deerfield, Conway, and Sunderland are still at 7.
Okay. Let's make it at 6.
No, Waitley and Conway are together now.
Well, I thought we were. Well, you guys
I didn't know if you were going to continue doing that.
Well, we can't. April, there's.
Right.
We can't.
We
can.
When we
this
can.
Month. We can't next month, but probably May. I don't see why not.
A couple in the fall look like they were good candidates for that.
Okay.
You don't like it? Oh,
it's hard for hard for payroll.
Right.
But isn't it better to have another meeting at the?
You know, it doesn't matter to us. We
right.
were doing it to make it
no,
easier
I know.
For you.
Yeah.
So
I do
and
appreciate
it really,
that.
And it's easier
you
for
and
the
Pat.
Superintendent,
right. but because we usually what the superintendent's saying is the same for all the schools. I have to immerse myself in Waitley on Waitley Day, and then immerse myself in Conway numbers
yeah.
on Conway Day. And it's very hard to do two of them in one day. I can get used to it, but right now it is a little bit of a difficult
home. You know what? Why don't we wait until Lynn gets here and find out? Because she,
yeah.
I don't know if she's going to be commuting from
Warwick.
North New Hampshire or
moving.
I don't think she's moving in it right away, was what
so,
we gathered.
She mentioned that she might
eventually
spend more time in the Warwick, in Warwick.
So anyway, I think we're set for the next few meetings, so move to adjourn?
Move to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
I think everyone moved.
I was going to say.